Welcome students. Today we'll learn about microwave assisted synthesis. Microwave is an electromagnetic spectrum. It lies between infrared radiation and radio waves. So it is radiation between IR and MR. Microwaves have a wavelength of 1 millimeter to 1 corresponding to frequencies between 1 and 300 gigahertz. Although there is a range of wavelengths of microwave intended for heating, operates is regulated at 12.2 centimeter corresponding hertz. Now, there are several advantages of microwave assisted synthesis that microwaves generate rapid intense heating of polar substances, which consequently reduces reaction times. Many reactions which are under microwave or done using microwave irradiation result in higher yield as compared to the conventional heating. Other advantage of, or the main advantage of microwave, is in-core heating. That means the bulk of the material in the reaction vessel is heated rather than the walls of the vessel, and it is in more homogeneous and selective manner. In microwave, you employ generally smaller volume of solvent to carry out the reactions. So as a result, there is savings in the cost, and which diminishes the waste problem, waste disposal problem. This method provides rapid and relatively inexpensive access to very high temperatures and pressure. This microwave reactions are generally performed on solid support. Now, this solid support can be reused again from or recycled and reused in another reaction. So this is an environmentally benign technique or environmentally friendly techniques, resulting in no highly contaminating residues or less high contaminating residues. Thus, microwave is a current approach in green chemistry, which involves design and redesign of chemical synthesis and chemical products to prevent environmental pollution. Although there are several advantages, microwaves have certain limitations. The reactions are carried out in microwave are in millimoles, resulting in small amounts of products. This is the R&D scale which I am talking about. Generally, in industries, you require tons of API or tons of end products, which is not possible using microwave, because microwave we generally employ very small quantities of product. These procedures are strongly limited by the presence of solvent which reach their boiling point within a very short time of exposure to microwaves. So there is a very limited range of solvents which can be used for heating or in the reaction mixture. Although the solid support which are used are environmentally friendly, it has a limitation that reaction over this solid support may run slow due to the diffusional constraints of the heat transfer. Because you are using the solid material, there is less diffusion of heat through the material in this solid support. And plus, the side reaction with the solid support as such may occur. Although solid supports are inert material, it can have certain side reactions. Now, there are certain precautions to be taken while you are using a microwave or doing a microwave assisted synthesis. Volatile reactants under superheated condition, we'll come back to this, what is superheated or superheating effect called. Volatile reactants under superheated condition may result in explosive conditions. plus the volume of the reaction mixture is to be kept between 10 to 5% of the volume of the container. This is to avoid the explosive nature of this volatile solvents. By using a solid support, you can safely handle toxic, explosive and noxious reagents. Although microwaves are as such safe to humans, prolonged exposure to microwave radiations may result in complete degeneration of body tissues and cells, and it may penetrate the skin and affect the body organs as well. How this microwave generate heat? Now, all the materials are not susceptible to microwave heating as response to various materials of microwave radiation is diverse. Based on their response to microwave, these materials can be broadly classified as materials that are transparent to microwaves, which is sulfur, or materials that reflect the microwaves, which is copper, materials that absorb microwave, which is water. And this is the material which we are interested in. Since microwave is an electromagnetic radiation, like any study involved or any reaction involving an electromagnetic radiation, the prerequisite for that reaction to occur, that material must absorb that electromagnetic radiation. Like in case of photochemistry, of the reaction to take place via a photochemical pathway, the material has to absorb light. Similarly, in microwave also, for the materials to undergo microwave assisted synthesis, it has to absorb that microwave radiation. So materials which absorb microwave radiation, that is the prerequisite for any microwave assisted synthesis. Is absorbing, is of no use. How are this microwave radiation generating heat in the system? There are two different mechanisms operating simultaneously. In fact, these are dipolar polarization and conduction mechanism. First, let us look at that question. For a substance to generate heat when irradiated with a microwave, it must possess a dipole moment. What is a dipole moment? That is, its molecular structure must be partially negative and partially positively charged. Say, take an example of this. Carbonyl compound, say formaldehyde. Now, oxygen being an electronegative atom, what will it do? It will withdraw electrons from the carbon towards itself and develop a partial negative charge. And carbon, because it is losing its electrons to the oxygen, it will develop a partial positive charge. So this is the dipole which we are talking about. For a substance to generate heat, it must possess a dipole moment, that its molecular structure must be partially negative and partially positive. So in this diagram which is shown, this is, say, let us take, this is a formaldehyde, this is the carbon of the formaldehyde, and this is the oxygen of the formaldehyde. Now, microwave is an electromagnetic radiation. So it contains both electric field as well as the magnetic field. In fact, the electric field of the microwave radiation is responsible for heating. Why? Because the dipole which is there, it tries to reorient itself to the alternating electric field. It is an alternating electric field. It tries to reorient itself. And in doing so, it loses energy in form of heat due to molecular friction. The friction may be due to friction is due to interaction with other dipoles or some other molecules which may not be dipoles in the reaction mixture as such. Now, this interparticular interaction which is there that can generate heat by interaction between dipolar solvents such as water, methanol and ethanol, or interaction between polar solutes, molecules such as ammonia and formic acid, or in the previous example, formaldehyde. The key requirement for dipolar polarization is that the frequency range of this oscillating electric field, the key requirement for dipolarization and polarization is that the frequency range of the oscillating electric field should be appropriate to enable the adequate interparticle interaction. Which interaction we are talking about? This interaction between the polar solvent molecules or polar solute molecules. If the frequency range is very high, the intermolecular forces will stop the motion of the polar molecule before it tries to align itself to the field, resulting in inadequate interparticle interaction. That is, there are certain intermolecular forces which stop the motion of polar molecule if the frequency range is very high. Conversely, if the frequency range is very low, what happens that the polar molecule gets sufficient time to align itself. So there is no the reorientation which is there is very slow in this case. So as a result, the friction will also be very slow. So the heat generation again in this is very low. The interparticle interaction is low in this case. In both the cases wherein it is high and it is low, the interparticle interaction is less. Now, microwave radiation has this appropriate frequency or the optimal frequency of 0.3 to 300 gigahertz to oscillate the polar particles and enable enough interparticle interaction to take place. Let us look at the second mechanism, that is the ionic conduction. The conduction mechanism generates heat through resistant to an electric field. Now, what is this resistant? What is this electric field? We will see now. The oscillating electromagnetic field, oscillating field which is there, generates oscillation of electrons and ions present in the reaction mixture. This can be ions present in the reaction mixture or also the electrons which are loosely held in the molecules, or some metal this can have also loosely held electrons. So what it does in the presence of this alternating electric field, this molecule also oscillates. And during this oscillation, what happens that it collides with the other charged particles with the neighboring molecules or neighboring charged molecules. So it is again as in case of dipole interaction, that is dipolar polarization. It is not that it is molecular friction with the neighboring dipole, it can be any molecule. So in this case also the collision is not only with the neighboring charged molecule, it can be any molecule or atom which are ultimately responsible for creating a heating. A solution containing ions or even a single isolated ion with a hydrogen bonded cluster in the sample will move through the solution under the influence of an electric field, resulting in the expenditure of energy due to increased collision rate, converting this kinetic energy to heat. What is happening? Even it is not necessary that it should contain a huge number of ions. Even a single ion which is moving under the influence of the electric field, what will happen? It will, since this movement is enhanced in the presence of microwave, it creates or increases the kinetic energy of that molecule, which increases the collision rate and subsequently the heat is formed. This induced currents, which is obtained by the microwave, will cause heating in the sample due to any electric resistance. Why this is electric resistance? Because there is movement of ions which will induce a certain current, and the collision will resist this electrical resistance. The collision will resist this electrical resistance. Fact, as I said, sir, earlier, both these mechanisms are occurring simultaneously. The heat produced by the conductivity mechanism is much stronger, that is the conducting mechanism is much stronger interaction than the dipolar mechanism. As a result, the heat generation capacity is also more in the conductivity mechanism. Thus, the heat generated by the conduction mechanism due to the presence of ions adds to the heat produced by the dipolar mechanism produced by the dipoles, resulting in a final higher temperature. That is, it is acting as a synergistic effect. Dipolar polarization and ionic conduction act synergistically. Now, there is something called as superheating effect of microwave, which we have seen in the limitations of the microwave. Now, to explain this superheating effect, let us take an example or a simple example. Say, suppose you are drinking a black coffee and you have left it on table and started doing some work. And then you realize that the coffee is too cold. So, what you do is heat it in a microwave oven. Again, you forget to take it out from the microwave oven. It cools down. So, what you do is, again, you reheat that. This process you have done twice or thrice, and then you realize, oh, the coffee is in the microwave. I should take it out. Now, what happens that when you take this coffee from the microwave, it suddenly smashes out. This is called as the superheating effect. A superheating effect is the phenomenon in which the liquid is heated. The liquid is heated to a temperature higher than its boiling point without boiling. So, it is possible in a microwave that the liquid can be heated higher than its boiling point without boiling. This higher than normal boiling temperature may be maintained for many hours, as you have forgotten the coffee cup to remove from. So, this is maintained for many hours, and as such, an equilibrium is established between this microwave energy input and a range of heat loss mechanisms. Okay. So, as long as there is an energy input, what will happen? There is an equilibrium existed between the energy input and a heat loss mechanism. So, you must be recalling that a system, when it is heated, what happens is simultaneously it is also losing heat to the system or the atmosphere. Okay. So, there is an equilibrium established, and there is this normal being our normal boiling temperature, higher than normal boiling temperature is maintained for many hours as long as there is this microwave energy input. This temperature is referred to as nucleation limited boiling point. We'll come back to this. What is nucleation limited? For now, this temperature is referred to as nucleation limited boiling point. Now, removal of this microwave power leads to a rapid drop in the observed temperature close to the conventional boiling point, and thus there is this flashing. So, as long as there is this microwave energy input, there is an equilibrium existed between this energy input and loss, and the temperature is maintained. As soon as you remove this microwave power, there is drop in the temperature to the conventional boiling point, and thus there is boiling occurring. Now, this superheating effect is achieved by heating a homogeneous substance. When this superheating is observed is that when you heat a homogeneous substance in a clean container pre op nucleation sites while taking care not to disturb the liquid. Now, take the example of coffee. Black coffee is a homogeneous mixture. Obviously, we take a clean coffee mug, which is free from nucleation site. For time being, nucleation sites are certain cavities, pits, and scratches on the surface. So obviously, you will not take a mug which is having such scratches or cavities in this case. And plus, you are not disturbing the liquid. You forgot the coffee to take out from microwave for a prolonged period of time. Okay. When these conditions are there, then only this superheating effect is achieved. We said pre-op nucleation site. What are these nucleation sites? Nucleation sites are the cavities, pits, and scratches on the surface of the vessel in contact with the liquid. I repeat, nucleation sites are the cavities, pits, scratches on the surface of the vessel with which the liquid is in contact and in which the bubble can form. These are the cavities, pits, wherein the bubbles will form. Now, boiling starts when this bubble, there are three stages for this bubble formation. First is initiation wherein the bubble will enclose the air entrapped between the cavities, pits or the scratches, and it grows in size as the temperature is increased, and at the temperature wherein it reaches the boiling point temperature, the bubble will blast out or will explode. Okay, so this nucleation sites are very important for the bubbling to occur. To understand the superheating effect wherein the temperature is raised beyond the boiling point, we have to look at how the conventional boiling occurs. In conventional boiling, that is first in conventional heating, the thermal energy is supplied to the vessel walls themselves by heating a mantle. And then this energy from the heated walls is transferred to the liquid in the vessel, the bulk of the liquid in the vessels. So energy is transferred from outside to inside. So the conventional boiling occurs from the surface of the container vessel at suitable nucleation sites. So these nucleation sites which are there on the surface of the vessel, which is the contact of the liquid. So this, as the temperature is increased, and thus the boiling starts. So, however, in microwave there is in-core heating. That means the bulk of the material is heated first, and then it is then transferred to the outer wall of the flask or the container vessel. And plus, it is continuously being cooled by the convective airflow. So, as a result, what will happen? The bulk temperature, the temperature of the bulk solution, which is there in the vessel, is slightly higher than the temperature of the layer of the solvent, which is at the walls. Let us look at this in a diagrammatic fashion. This is your beaker. This is your bulk of the liquid. So microwave irradiation is there. Direct. So this heats the bulk of the liquid. So this temperature is slightly higher than this because this is continuously being cooled by the convection airflow. Okay. As a result, temperature here is slightly higher than the layer of the solvent which is adjacent to this vessel. Now, when the bulk temperature rises to NLBP, that is nucleation limited boiling point, the heating of the layer of the adjacent to the walls approaches the temperature required for the bubble formation. That is wherein the bubble will start boiling. As long as the microwave energy input is there, this will not occur because the bulk of the liquid is slightly higher than your boiling point here. So when you are removing the microwave energy input, what will happen?
the equilibrium is lost and this temperature is dropped down to the temperature of this adjacent layer, and this bubble formation will start from the outer vessel. Now we have seen the superheating effect of the microwave, wherein the liquid is heated to a temperature higher than its boiling point. Without boiling, we have seen how it is done. Now, there is something called as solvent effect of the microwave. So let us take an example wherein you are heating water and 1-4 dioxane. You are exposing both these solutions or both these solvents to the same power, microwave power, same microwave frequency, same time, same volume. After heating it for certain time, say 5 minutes, you will observe that the temperature in the water is higher than the temperature in 1-4 dioxane. Okay. So, why this is so? Because water is a polar solvent and 1-4 dioxane, it is a less polar solvent. So, you may conclude that more polar the solvent, that is higher the dielectric constant, that how you measure the polarity of the solvent is by measuring its dielectric constant. More the polar, that is higher the dielectric constant, more readily the microwave radiation is absorbed and higher the temperature is obtained. Now this is true in case of water and 1-4 dioxane, since there is a huge difference of dielectric constant. The water's dielectric constant is 80. 1,4 dioxide, it is somewhere around 2 to 4, if I am correct. So when there is this huge difference, obviously this holds true. But if you are taking, however, if you are taking two solvents with comparable dielectric constants, such as ethanol and acetone, acetone has a dielectric constant of 20.6 and ethanol has a dielectric constant of 24.6. When these are heated at same radiation power and for same period of time, the final temperature in ethanol will be much higher than in acetone. This is called as the solvent effect. Now, this ability of the solvent to generate heat from microwave irradiation depends on the ability of the solvent to absorb microwave energy and then to convert this absorb microwave energy into the heat. Now, these factors can be considered using a new term called as loss angle, which is expressed by Greek letter delta. And it is mathematically expressed as tan delta. It is the ratio of epsilon double prime to epsilon single prime. What does epsilon single prime represent? It is the ability of dielectric material to store electric potential energy under the influence of electric field. That is, it is the ability or a power of this absorbing. It is the indication of this absorbing power. Whereas epsilon double prime, the loss factor, it is called as loss factor. It is quantifies the efficiency with which the absorbed energy is converted to heat. So it is this conversion efficiency, this loss factor, tells us about the conversion efficiency. Thus, for solvents with comparable dielectric constant and low tan delta value, the loss factor epsilon double prime accounts for the ability of the solvent to convert the microwave energy into the thermal energy. Now, ethanol possesses higher loss tan delta value, thus couples better with microwave irradiation, resulting in more rapid increase in the temperature. Recall that delta is a ratio of epsilon double prime upon epsilon single prime. Now, since this is the ability of that dielectric material to absorb, and it is equivalent to the dielectric constant when the material is exposed to static electricity. So this is comparable. So since the dielectric constants are comparable, this also will be comparable. So only limiting factor will be the loss factor in this case, and which will dictate the loss tangent value. So because the conversion efficiency of ethanol is higher than acetone, conversion efficiency, and that means conversion of microwave to thermal energy is higher in case of ethanol, it will result in more rapid increase in temperature. Now, this ability of solvent to convert, absorb microwave energy into heat is also dependent on the frequency and the temperature. Since many microwave apparatus is set at a frequency, certain frequency 2.4 gigahertz, the dielectric constant can only change with the temperature. So when a solvent is heated, the dielectric constant decreases as the temperature increases. Say for example, water has a dielectric constant of 80 to 78 at room temperature. It decreases to 20 when it is heated to 300. Now, since only dipoles or the polar molecules show microwave absorption, it can be concluded that polar solvents or non-polar materials cannot be heated under microwave irradiation. However, the addition of polar solvents can increase the heating rate. This you can explain by taking an example. So you take a non-polar solvent such as toluene in one beaker. In another beaker, you take same non-polar solvent and add a little acetone, which is a polar solvent. Say in one beaker you have taken 100 ml toluene, in another beaker you have taken 90 ml of toluene and 10 ml of acetone. The final temperature which is there after heating for same temperature and same time, you will observe that the final temperature in the mixture of acetone and toluene is higher because addition of polar solvent such as acetone has increased the rate. This increasing the heating rate can also be done by addition of salts. This is because microwave heating is also due to ionic mechanism or ionic conduction mechanism. Addition of salt, which are ion pairs, also can increase the heating rate. However, this is limited by the solubility problem. This solubility problem you can remove if you use ionic liquids which also absorb microwave irradiation efficiently, and plus these have one more advantage that it exhibit low vapor pressure. Remember, there was a limitation that certain volatile solvents can result in explosion. This is because they have very high vapor pressure. Ionic liquids have a low vapor pressure. Ionic liquids are salts which are at room salts which are liquids at room temperature. So this being salts, they dissolve in wide range of organic solvent as compared to water and alcohol. Some ionic liquids are soluble in many non-polar solvents and therefore can be used for microwave coupling agents when microwave transparent solvents are employed. Now, you have seen during the advantages, or the first advantage was in the reduction of the reaction time. This is due to the increased reaction rate. So to account for this, let us look at the RNS equation, which is rate constant is equal to this pre-exponential factor A, and this is exponential terms of this delta G here. Although it is delta G, it is Ea, energy of activation, and R is the gas constant, ideal gas constant, and T is the temperature in Kelvin. There are two ways scientists believe that microwave radiation can increase the rate of chemical reaction. First is that the pre-exponential factor, by affecting the pre-exponential factor, which describes the molecular mobility of the materials involved, and which depends on the frequency of the vibrations of the molecules at the reaction interface. So higher the frequency, higher the reaction rate of vibration. Since microwaves induce an increase in molecular vibrations,
this microwave will increase the reaction rate by affecting the air. Secondly, some scientists believe that microwave irradiation produces an alteration in the exponential factor by affecting this free energy of activation. Now, recall that advantage of there is intense heating observed in microwave. So certain transition state which are not obtained during conventional synthesis are obtained by this superheating effect. Therefore, in a shorter period of time, therefore this is affected, and overall the rate constant is also affected. So there are two ways that can, first is by increasing the frequency of vibration and by altering the pathway or the way which the transition state is achieved. Let us look at some examples of microwave assisted synthesis. We'll be dealing with synthesis of 5-membered heterocyclic rings, synthesis of 6-membered heterocyclic rings, synthesis of polycyclic heterocyclic rings, and lastly some in general organic reactions. So first, synthesis of pyrroles. This is a classical Pall-Mall cyclization of 1,4 diketones. Why this alcohol has 1,4? This is 1,2,3,4, 1,4 diketones. Okay. In conventional, you require a Lewis acid activation and the reaction occurs or completes in 12 hours. Whereas in microwave, it is completed in 2 minutes, and plus you are not using any solvent. This is a solvent-free reaction. Next example is synthesis of triazole. Again, in this, the conventional heating requires 60 minutes and the yields are also very less, 45% to 60%. Whereas in microwave, the reaction is obtained in 10 minutes and the reaction is yields are obtained in a higher yield. Next is synthesis of imidazole. This is preparation from an aldehyde and a diketone, 1,2 diketone in this case, and ammonium acetate. Okay, you can see for conventional synthesis, you require 4 hours of reflux in acetic acid. Whereas in microwave, this reaction is without any solvent, so you are not using any acetic acid, and plus the reaction time is reduced to 10 minutes. Next is 6-membered rings. Dihydropyridine, your hands pyridine synthesis, wherein you take ethyl acetate and benzaldehyde and ammonia. In this case, you are taking ammonium hydroxide, alkaline ammonia. Okay. In conventional method, the yields are very low, 15% to 16%, and the reaction time is also 12 hours. Whereas in case of microwave, it is 10 to 15 minutes. Synthesis of polycyclic 6-membered rings. Why we are saying this polycyclic 6-membered rings? It is polycyclic and each cycle is composed of six carbons, or it is a 6-membered ring. Each ring is a 6-membered ring. So this is your Stroop synthesis involving a aromatic amine with an acrylate. Okay. In conventional, you use sulfuric acid and you get low yield. So, however, in microwave, you get 80% to 87% yield, and again, it is solvent-free. You are using indium chloride on a silica. This is your solid support, therefore, this is a solvent-free reaction. Other than heterocyclic chemistry, the microwave has application in several nucleophilic aromatic substances as well. You can see, for conventional, it requires 12 to 24 hours and the reaction yields are also very low, 35% to 60%. But in microwaves, the reaction is completed within 10 minutes and almost 100% in all the cases it is observed. This is a nucleophilic aromatic substitution wherein the chlorine is being substituted for the aliphatic amines here. So this completes your microwave assisted synthesis.